Hey, this is Shirish Kulkarni, founder and CEO of Stroth Consulting, which is a business consulting venture started 5 years back as my passion to give back to the industry, helping small and medium businesses to grow. Now, with this new concept called as Hatke, we're talking to various personalities, thought leaders, entrepreneurs, who look at the situation in a different way. We call it Hatke way, and find out tenets in which they themselves get encouraged, motivated, they keep themselves that kind of an edge as a leadership, and they reflect back and also influence others to really be part of that whole journey. And we have a great honor to have Siddharth Shirole today with us, who is not only an entrepreneur who is running his own business in hoteling, but also a multifaceted personality to have written his own book. He dabbles into music, likes singing. So Siddharth, great to have you on this platform.
Thank you, Suresh, and I'm so glad that I'm interacting with you and through your medium to all the people around. And it's a privilege also, and it's a pleasure also to be interacting at the platform, because you yourself have begun on a very inspiring journey of giving back to the society, nation, and humanity. And I think that in itself will encourage a lot more people to think beyond themselves. So I think such kind of initiatives are very important. And the more people think beyond self, I think the world will be definitely a much more harmonious place to live in. So it's a pleasure for me too.
Wonderful. I think that's a great start. A lot of positivity I'm experiencing here, Siddharth. Looking at, you know, some people are calling this situation as lockdown, you know, virus outbreak, and there is a darkness. So how do you look at your own business in the current context? Is it a challenge? I mean, is there an opportunity? How do you look at this situation, Siddharth?
See, first, I feel, Shirish, is that any situation should be first accepted. Mm. Until and unless you accept any situation, you cannot move ahead in a constructive direction. Mm. So I have firstly accepted the fact that this is a global lockdown. This is not only for my city. It is not only for my country. It is for the entire globe. So what I am facing, the entire globe is facing. There is no one different. It is universal. And now that this problem has happened, now, first step is acceptance. The longer you take to accept any situation, the harder it becomes to recover and then further, come out of it. So I would appeal to everyone who are listening to this or feel a little left out. I think first step towards getting out of the situation is completely humble acceptance of the situation that we are in. Mm-hmm. Having said that, now that we first, once we accept the whole situation, that's when our creative energies start, visiting us and, start guiding us towards how do we navigate through this whole process of, total, how do you get out of this
kind of challenge or kind of difficulty, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Correct. So it's important that, once the acceptance factor sinks in, after that, the creativity obviously the whole knowledge about how the world is, keeping up with it. We need to be updated. Mm-hmm. And every business has a different texture. Now, suppose I'm into a hospitality business.
Right.
So let me tell you one thing is that in the end, we should be looking from our consumer point of view. Some businesses can start earlier. Mm-hmm. Some businesses might take time to, get a ride in its own way. But we have to be consumer centric. We have to understand that when do you think the consumer related to our industry is going to be out in the market. Now in a hospitality industry, suppose I'm in a hospitality industry.
Right.
I know for a matter of fact that it's going to take a long time for people to come out into a restaurant and eat.
Superb. Yeah. That's
true. And hence, because everybody's circumcised, we are not calling anyone at a house for a dinner or a lunch.
Right.
So, you know, it is going to be, even if the lockdown is, you know, it's opened up in the next 2 weeks or 3 weeks, it is still going to take time for people to be confident because the vaccine isn't there.
Right.
And hence, it will be a little circumspect. So, in my industry, in the hospitality industry, I envisage that, you know, people won't be so comfortable initially of coming out until the numbers of COVID-19 drastically drop down. There is no fresh case in reported for at least 3 weeks. And this is what I think practically. I'm not scaring away anyone. This is what I've accepted, and I'm thinking practically, if anything miraculous happens, it's more than welcome. So you have to be prepared for the worst and then do your best. So I think this is how I see that, you know, if it is consumer centric. So in hospitality, I see that there is more scope for home deliveries.
Right.
But then again, you know, every industry has its own mathematics. And my first advice to everyone would be to be safe in the current circumstances.
Right.
Our earlier liabilities have a probability of getting help through the government, through because it's a global issue. So private sector is we are going to seek out for help, and I'm sure our government is going to be reaching out to us and helping us in our initiative to rebuild again. But having said that, newer liabilities need to be thought about, you know. So it's wiser to stay where you are currently until it's a consumer requirement. And once you realize that, yes, now now the consumers are looking forward to our services of our specific sector. Uh-huh. That's when we should move towards, you know, towards resurrecting our entire business.
I think what I'm hearing is that you have to introspect where we are, what services we are giving, what is my consumer, what is the situation in which that consumer is going to be ready with that kind of a need to really consume my business, and then hence plan it accordingly and accept it. Like, okay, it might be 6 months, 8 months, 15 months moving forward from there, and be ready with Absolutely. That diversification. I think that is what you're saying. Siddharth, moving forward.
It has to be customized. Yeah. It has to be customized as per your own business
context.
Business that you are involved in.
Wow, wonderful. I'll take you something maybe a little bit dear and near to you. So what is this words, Shabari, Parichay, Sharvari, Jhaika mean for you? I think I find a little bit of resonance in the name. So I'm asking this question.
Yeah. So my father started off with this restaurant called Shabari in 1984. And it is a Maharashtrian thali that we've been serving for the last 36 years in Pune. Wow. And it's quite a renowned restaurant, and I grew up, I mean, I my livelihood was because of this restaurant. Then my father began with this all in the same property. It is a hotel called Parichay, which is a two-star accommodation, 2.5-star accommodation, which in the central part of Pune. Then when I became an engineer and I started, you know, after my engineering, I decided to venture out into the hospitality business that I had inherited. And hence, I started off with a restaurant called Sharvari. It is again in the same property. One is a Maharashtrian thali, one is a lodge, and one is a fast food restaurant, vegetarian fast food restaurant. And in 2010, we started Zaika, which is a spice-based ice cream, like long, elaichi, dalchini, kalimiri. And now for the last 10 years, it's also doing quite well. So this is basically what I do. This is my small, but, you know, it's a fulfilling entire group of diverse hospitality Wonderful. Products that we have got together, and we've been operating on the same.
Superb. So something based on spices in Indian food, and that too in ice cream model. I think it's absolutely hotke, right? I mean, it's
absolutely. You must try it once, Shirish.
sure. Now you know I am resonating with the song. Actually, I know you like music, so and maybe I'll ask this question. Musafir hu yaro, na ghar hai na thikana. Does that resonate with what you are thinking?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, it is obviously a journey. It's never a destination. And you have to keep walking. I mean, you know, just the other day I was watching Castaway. Mm. And the last lines that Tom Hanks had to say is that, you know, when there is no hope, when it's all against the odds, all you need to do is keep breathing.
Wow.
And try to keep yourself alive. And that's how you might overcome the toughest of odds. And you know, something that sinked into my mind that, you know, all you have to do is just keep breathing and keep walking. So there are, see, whichever destination we reach, we just have to look back for a while, rest a little while, and then move on to newer pastures. That is life, you know. So absolutely, it's musafir ho yaro, na ghar hai thikana, na thikana.
Kya baat hai. So actually, the most important companion that we have is you know, the books, where we yeah. spend time with it. And so you are dabbled into both reading and also writing, I think. So how do you see that is important to build your inner strength, to build that motivation, to build that, you know, power to real circumvent and not let anything which is negative touch you? Is that it creates a kind of a shield around you, Siddharth?
See, I think for your confidence, it is important that you have your own knowledge. Knowledge builds on confidence. So I think reading for me is that if I have a habit of reading every day. So supposedly what I have done for the past 1 year, it's been since I started reading extensively. I read one book, but I read for 30 minutes a day. Effectively, I start off with a book in, there are various verticals in books. Say, suppose there is optimism, there is health, there is political, there is economic vertical, or love or relationships. So whatever verticals that interests you, you know, there has to be an interest that you are looking forward to seek knowledge about this particular aspect of your life.
Okay.
And then you purchase books in those verticals as of now in the current state of mind, and then you start reading a particular book. So what I experienced is that I started reading daily, but I started reading for 30 minutes. So in 30 minutes, if the topic is very interesting, I cover up to 30 pages, or otherwise I cover up to say 15 to 20 pages. But the point is that if you consistently make it a ritual, every day you read for 30 days, 30 minutes, it's like 20 right. pages in the hindsight. So you finish a book of around 300 pages, which is normally a standard size. Right. You finish it in 10 days.
Wonderful.
In a month, you might finish 3 books. And in a year, you might finish 36 books. So, wow. You know, I finished around 19 books because somewhere, bigger in volume, somewhere kind of difficult to understand. But finish a book. When you start the book, you should finish a book and then move on to the next book. So what has happened is that every day reading, it fills my mind with more knowledge, and that because I'm more knowledgeable than yesterday, I feel more optimistic and more wiser. So I think reading is one of the most important aspects that everyone must indulge into, but consistency over intensity is a philosophy that I believe. You know, it is not how much you read. It is whether you read daily.
Wow.
Even if you read 5 pages, it's okay. But you read daily. So there is where I feel reading has just, you know, it just gives you different perspectives, different lives you lead. And then you compare it to your own life. You suddenly realize something out of metaphors. Mm. So if I'm reading about Mandela, the best thing that he said, that when he was going to jail, he said that, you must be prepared. He was about to be convicted. Either it was going to be a life sentence or death sentence.
Uh-oh.
So he said that you, in any situation, you have to prepare that this might happen to you. If you are not prepared that this might happen to you, then it is just wishful thinking. Hmm. So that was a metaphor which I related in this COVID-19 situation, that now I have to be because I'm into public life, I have to be prepared that this might happen to me.
Super.
And then when you battle it out, the chances of you overcoming it or emerging victorious are much better, rather than just thinking that this might never happen to you. So you know, this kind of metaphors you get out of nowhere, it's only because you kind of read on different aspects. So I think I definitely recommend reading, and writing is something which I, again, I write a daily blog on Tumblr. Recently I started, it's been around 3.5 months now. But if every day you make it a point that you express, for just jot down anything, suppose you're not into writing, but at least self-expression, self-journaling. This is what I feel, you know, this is how my day went like. And this is whatever, it's not necessary to share it to people, but to get it out of your system, whatever it is, you know, negative, positive, 5 to 10 minute ritual of just penning down something, either on your notepad or on your writing pad. I think that creates a vacuum to fill up with more energy and more knowledge.
Superb. So I think both the importance of going across to various types of verticals, as you said, of types of books and consuming it on a, most important is a regular basis, where the consistency and regularity is important. Also the messaging that it inherits into us and basically gets it to your system. While you're writing, it is where you're venting out your thoughts, positive thoughts.
Yes.
And get it there so that, you know, firstly, it is getting out of your system. Secondly, it is something that is getting consumed by a third party in a positive sense for a constructive reason.
Absolutely.
So, you know, it takes me to a little bit of a different thought of comparison. I was just reading your book and comparison between optimism, realism and pessimism. I think one has to have a balance in that. Or how do you look at optimism as a tool and power in that sense?
I feel that, you know, there is no harm in being optimistic. You know, what is the harm? Nuksan kya hai?
Nuksan
kya hai? So I see there is no reason to be, usme koi nuksan hi nahi. You know, even if you're realistic, thoda to nuksan hai, you know, at least you feel ki yaar, ye nahi soch paya main, aise to kuch, you know, you might regret it later. Lekin being optimistic, usme loss kya hai? The only thing is that you have to supplement it with a good work ethic. So if you are an optimist and you are a you have a good work ethic, then it is not like, you know, just you're dreaming without any actions. So support optimism with a good work ethic, and I don't think there's a better formula in this world than being disciplined and being optimistic. I would rather, you know, not even think of any other situation to be in. So this is the core philosophy of my life, to improve self-discipline and always stay optimistic.
Superb. So maybe I'll just take a little bit of turn and take you back to an event. How important is climbing Sinhagad in your life? I'm just taking that example.
You know, that was like, I was diagnosed with a slip disc, multiple slip disc, and it was at that point of time, I was 26 years old. And you know, I decided to go to a doctor, and he was like, he asked me, "What's your age?" I said, 26. He said, "Are you married?" I said, "Yes." So he said, "Okay, so what do you do?" I said, "I look after a hotel." So he said, "Okay, now do one thing. Now next 1 month, you're not going to go anywhere. Now you're never going to
be able to
dance again. Neither you're going to, have the regular lifestyle that you've been having." I said, "What has happened?" He said, "No, you've been diagnosed with a multiple slip disc, and for you need complete bed rest." So at that point of time, my father used to always say, always have a second opinion. So second opinion was that I went to a doctor called Mr. Sharangpani, and he said, "You throw that report out of the room first.
Wow.
And you do this small exercises, and six exercises, which are very simple. I thought I was just sleeping. You know, I didn't even think it is, exercising. And he said, "You do this, and in 15 days, now you understand." But he said one thing: "Now you understand something, that you have to exercise for your entire life. This is maintenance for you.
Oh. Okay.
So if you do, then you can go and climb the Sinhagad. And if you don't do it, then you'll be reduced to sedentary work and life won't be the same again. So I that found, obviously that was something which was a very good deal, which I took. And yes, you know, when I finally climbed Sihargarh, it was hard to believe at first. But when I climbed Sihargarh and I was fine, fit and healthy, I think after that, I never looked back. You know, it is just one of those stories of overcoming. And that time I read about Lance Armstrong's Every Second Counts, you know.
Yes.
I was going through a slip disc. He had gone through cancer. But again, when you use metaphors, you know, whatever situation you are in, you should read something which is which you're seeking. In that aspect, if you start reading, reading becomes interesting because you draw comparisons from their experiences and compare it through metaphors into your life. And that gives you a you know, like an direction as in how you can navigate through through out of the problem.
Right. So basically look at any example, may it be a leadership, may it be something out of the book, to make it as something which actually you can refer to and translate back to your own experiences and come out of what you are, to make it as a motivational element. I think that's what you're trying to do.
Yeah, you have to drive you have to derive a moral.
Moral,
you know?
Okay.
The point is that when you read something, you gain knowledge. So knowledge is fine. But if you introspect on the knowledge that you have gained and come out with a moral, you gain wisdom. And to use wisdom in your daily life, I think it to first gain knowledge and then derive wisdom and inculcate that wisdom into your daily life, I think that takes you to a different level.
Nicely said. Let's turn ourselves into you know, importance of recognizing, importance of connecting, importance of appreciation. So how important is, you know, recognition or appreciation as a part of the whole journey? In parlance of corporate, definitely it is said as something one must do. But in your view, how is appreciation that could be a turning point in life?
Yeah, I think appreciation is extremely important because see, if you are confident or you are doing well in life, I think, you know, if there are more people doing well in life, more people, you know, aspiring, realizing their dreams, you know, the world or the neighborhood should be an harmonious place to live. Aap aise socho ki main akela hi achha kar raha hu and baaki log achha nahi kar rahe. So there will be a lot of enviousness, right, which will hit us in the long term. So what we experience, how we evolve, and if we start appreciating people around us, that will help them grow. And if everyone around us is doing well, now see, everyone in the globe is sitting at home. Okay. So wasn't it better that every country or every business was prospering when the times were good? And that time we used to feel, are nahi mera acha hai ya uska acha hai, aaj sabka bad gaya. So the point is that if you begin to appreciate, obviously the appreciation has to be genuine.
True.
Then it can just hit a person, so it you can connect with a person so beautifully if you observe any good quality and make it a point that you appreciate it. I think you're making the world a better place by you know, inculcating this habit of appreciating, genuine appreciation of the people around you or the neighborhood around you. I think it will go a long way towards making a harmonious relationships within your circle, and it'll have its ripple effect towards in your neighborhood and the society also.
Wonderfully said. I think this touch of words which are positive definitely helps us to really get motivated. Now for me, I would say Ratan Tata had been my role model when I was working with Tata Motors telco at that point in time. Once I had an opportunity to meet him, and it was like a dream come true for me, and a lifetime. That experience of maybe a 3-minute kind of conversation with him is driving my life. So in your view, how important is a model, role model, importance of role model or mentors in a life?
See, I think, you know, till the time we come to solace with ourselves, or we become in peace or in sync with ourselves, it is always necessary that you look up to someone. Because it's a journey, you know, ours is an individual journey, which needs inspiration at the right time, you know, when specifically you have that vacuum within. So for example, I you know, while I was growing, I'm not that fairer, you know, to not as fair as, you know, I'm a wheatish kind of skin boy. So I was thinking, yaar, मेरे जैसा दिखने वाला कोई सक्सेसफुल है क्या? तो मैंने दैट टाइम इन द इंडस्ट्री अजय देवगन आया था, यू नो, आई फाउंड व्हाई आई लाइक हिम बिकॉज़ ही वाज ब्रिटिश, ओके, ए, तो मुझे ऐसा लगा नहीं ये मेरे जैसा है, थोड़ा सिमिलर, सो आई स्टार्टेड लाइकिंग हिम, एंड उसके बाद यू नो इन डिफरेंट ऑल डिफरेंट वर्टिकल्स, इफ यू, but it should be in sync with you somewhere, like in cricket I used to like Mohammad Azharuddin, and I used to look up to him in the 80s when he became the captain, and I used to like his style, and you know,
so throwing from the slip,
there
right?
are so many people throwing from the slip, so you know, just the collar kaise ye karta tha and how he used to speak, but and yeah. You know, so different, firstly there is a pulse that hits your instinct about someone that when you see and you feel that yaar isme kuch hai, to fir shayad wo aisa turn out baad mein na ho, lekin zyada karke agar tumhari instinct instinct whispers, they say, you know, and it's very difficult to listen to it, but if we actually begin to listen to the whispers of our instinct, I think that is the best guide that we can have in life, because our instinct generally doesn't fail. So in and all, I have this, you know, I have a lot of role models in my life that I used to read about, like Rafael Nadal, for example, in sports. I don't know. I just, he just inspires me no end. So this is the way, you know, I used to, whichever my instinctively, I used to feel that, you know, I need to follow him or learn from him. I used to read about him, and I used to have a daily routine of my 5-6 mentors and what they are doing every day, or search for them. And just that gives you a little bit of optimism. You read their thoughts, you gain something out of it. But it again has to be customized and instinct based, and not because someone is following him, I'm following him. So his thoughts, and then naturally those thoughts and your thoughts start aligning on a spiritual level.
Starts resonating, yeah.
Exactly, starts resonating, and that's how I feel. You know, that's how you can stay motivated, and also believe that you know, if he can do it, I can. So I think that is what mentors are there for. You know, they have shown that they have been there, done that, and it is possible. And that, I think, is very important for you to believe that, yes, it is possible. So, I think that's about it. You know, that's what I feel about mentorship. Okay. You must have mentors.
Superb. You know, just going through a little bit mythological way, we call, you know, ki duniya mein sab ganda ho jaye, bura ho jaye, to pralay aata hai. You know, there is this thing called as pralay, where God will wash out all the bad things. Now, in the current situation, I believe, now this is my thought process, I would like to see, hear your views on that, that only human being for his or her kind of ways that we have treated nature, that nature is giving back pralay, and it's a lockdown only for humans, all animals, see the rivers are flowing, the trees are outside, the air is flowing, everything is hunky-dory, but humans are locked down. So, what do you look at this as, pralay, in your perspective? What is your perspective?
See, I think every experience is an experience in itself. I don't know, you know, why it happened, or whether we are abusing the Mother Nature. But I definitely think that from this, we have a great opportunity to learn about ourselves. How the world conducts is a different ball game altogether after this post-COVID-19. But how we conduct ourselves now, it's a wonderful, beautiful time. In fact, I think, you know, See, I'm reading Mandela. He was there in the prison for 27 years. Mm. My father was in prison for 1 year during the emergency.
Right.
He once mentioned to me that he never got bored in prison and he enjoyed the time completely.
My God.
So I think it is, if you look at it as a problem, then you can, there are so many ways that, you know, you can start thinking about it. I think you should look at it as a blessing. I think this period, we are going to be talking about this period for as long as we live.
Yeah.
And this is not something which only our generation must have experienced. Those who are living right now must have experienced. And once we come out of it, it's going to be, there are so many things that you learn from this phase, you know, how to isolate yourself, how to reinvent yourself, how to improvise, how to stay inspired, how to break, to unlearn and then learn again. So I think for self-improvement, this is a blessing in disguise. How to start from the scratch. For example, someone is not doing in business. Again, it's a reset. You know, how do you rethink and you restart again? Someone who's doing well and has suddenly stopped is again now, how do you take it to the next level from this? So it's kind of a reset moment, which I think is a blessing in disguise. It's never going to happen again. And I think there are going to be stories, scripts, there are going to be, you know, a lot of study about it. And this is a phase that's going to be written about and read about for a long, long time to come. And I think we must go through it, experience it beautifully, experience each day, try to document it, try to reflect. And once we come out of this, I think if we manage to keep these practices that we've learned from now in this period, I think it'll take us to an altogether different direction in life.
Wonderful, wonderful. I see a great sense of gratitude into it, right? Giving this reflection to look at the situation in a positive way. Thank that this opportunity is thrown at us rather than looking at this as a challenge.
Exactly.
I think that is something that is getting reflected.
Like you said, you know, the Ganga is getting cleaner by the day. We don't need to spend so much money right now. See, everything is just beautiful around. Every city looks like a hill station right now. The weather is beautiful. That is, if you see the amount of diseases that are floating around have come down. I was just talking to a friend of mine who is in the medical industry.
Right.
And I asked him, "Yar, tera dhanda to jor se chal raha hoga." To wo mujhe bola, "Are kaay ka jor ka?" Bola, "Ye to sara khali mask aur ye leke ja rahe, baki dawai koi leke hi nahi ja raha." Bole, "Kyunki abhi to log ghar ka kha rahe, bahar nahi aa rahe, to acche khase healthy hai sab." So you know, I think this is a wonderful time to improve internal health and to introspect and evolve and experience.
I think whatever small statistics I have seen, hospitals reporting cases has reduced. Hospitals people actually required to attend emergency cases has reduced. Accidents have absolutely gone maybe to near zero. We are seeing less deaths also. If you there is a statistics on that also, that number of people getting burnt for Hindu. Though that has gone down. So I think it is a sea change. And a new term getting called as BC, not before Christ, but before Corona. would be something, as you are also reflecting on the same. I believe that is the thing. Now coming to a little bit of a conclusion, concluding part. I see that you are rounded with this. If I have to get the concept back, Hatke, H stands for A, health, A stands for attitude, T for technology, K for knowledge, and E for engagement. I think all these pillars, I think you touched in this way or that way, in the way that you reflected on your personality and business dimension. Taking it further to the young entrepreneurs or the budding entrepreneurs or entrepreneurs of maybe smaller size or bigger size, what's your kind of a message for them? You know, what is that they should be engaged onto or hooked onto to really, you know, free themselves first as themselves to come out of this situation, help ourselves first, and then eventually the larger, you know, other side, maybe employees or customers. So I wanted to hear that, Siddharth, from you.
You see, there is one thought of Swami Vivekananda that stuck with me for, I think it's been more than 2.5 decades now. My father used to keep a daily thought kind of a diary, it was, which was kept on the table. And every day, जैसे दिन बदलता था तो वो thought बदलता था. अभी बाकी thoughts मुझे ज़्यादा याद नहीं. लेकिन one day I read this thought कि be bold, be strong, and take the entire responsibility on your own shoulders. So I think it was 19 or 20 at that point of time, and I read this thought of Swami Vivekananda. I still remember it. I've not read it again, but that day I thought that I should take my own responsibility first, and taking on as much as responsibility on yourself, on your own shoulders, so what he says is be bold, be strong, and take the entire responsibility on your own shoulders. I think that if you do, ki hum kya karte hain normally, ये नहीं कर सकते, इसको ब्लेम करो, उसको ब्लेम करो, आई डोंट ब्लेम एनीवन,
वो करेगा, गवर्नमेंट करेगा, वो मदद करना चाहिए,
बिल्कुल नहीं. आई माइट सीक आउट, आई माइट सीक फॉर हेल्प, आई माइट रीच आउट फॉर हेल्प, बट आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू ब्लेम एनीवन फॉर माय डीड्स और माय करियर, माय फेलियर्स, माय सक्सेस. द पॉइंट इज दैट आई हैव डिसाइडेड दैट द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी इज माइन एंड इट्स ऑन माय शोल्डर्स. आई थिंक वंस यू गो इनटू द स्किन ऑफ दिस थॉट, after that things seem simpler because you're not blaming anyone, hence nobody comes out and blames you yourself are responsible for your own destiny. So try and take as much as responsibility as possible, and try to as a duty, not as a priority. You have to take it as a duty. There's a difference between priority is more towards your it might be called as selfish. But duty is a beautiful word, if you attach to your responsibility, I think you feel more purposeful. So this is one thought that I think I imbibe, and I've been living with it for the last 2 decades, and I think as long as I can manage, I will keep moving ahead with this thought.
Superb. I think Siddharth, that was extremely insightful. We could touch upon various dimensions of life, challenges in business, the way that you look at it as an opportunity to reinvent oneself. A lot of things related with spiritual aspect. And I think a young entrepreneur like you talking about so much of insightful spiritual dimension of life, it is definitely something which is going to motivate others who are kind of a little bit gloomy, or maybe looking up to somebody to help them out with thoughts. So it was wonderful having you, Siddharth, along with me. I understand your busy schedule, but thanks so much, Siddharth, for your time and your insights.
It was a pleasure, Shirish, and as you said, it was just a divine conversation, and even I, you never plan it, and it just flows, and I thoroughly enjoyed the entire conversation. And obviously, the questions were even more introspective and deep, and hence the answers could come out the way it did. So I think I look forward to many more conversations with you, and I hope and I am sure that through your craft, through your intent, you are going to give back to the society, nation, and humanity that the world really needs right now.
God bless. I think hatke is something, is a word actually. Hatke is a very common word actually in the world. But I thought to do my dues, my small Marathi madhe mantat khari chavata, mi kai karu shakto. So it's just a reflection of that. I'm just reaching out to personalities and the pure souls like you resonate. And this is the magic of being positive, being optimistic in the life, Siddharth. Any last words you have?
There's one thing I don't know. I'll have to read it for you. It's a beautiful thought that I think if it's about something beautiful that I read. So Steven Spielberg says, when you have a dream, it does not come at you screaming on your face. It only whispers. The hardest thing to listen to is your instincts and intuitions, because they always whisper. And it is really very hard to hear it. Every day, be ready to hear what whispers in your ears. Listen to the whispers, and if it tickles your heart, that is going to be what you should be doing for the rest of your life.
Kya baat hai. Superb, superb. I think that is a great, great note and insightful saying. I would just like to I've always been following J.W. Carver, G.W. Carver, who is a U.S. scientist. And I would like to end this interview with that quote. He says, start where you are. Start where you are with what you have. Start where you are with what you have. Never be satisfied. Make something out of it.
Correct.
So with that note, that keeps me motivated in my life. I think I just reflected my personality. Thank you so much, Siddharth. It was a kind of really blissful and extremely enjoyable discussion with you. Thank you so much. And our relationship will grow long way. Thank you so much.
Pleasure.
Bye.
Thank you.